And Susan?
Yes, you would, I'm here.
Okay, good, very good. All right, so we have everybody here, we have a form, go ahead and get started. The first thing is the approval of the agenda. Does anybody have any comments on the agenda, additions, deletions? If not, accept a motion to approve the agenda.
Motion to approve. Second.
All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none, agenda's approved. I sent the minutes after everybody. Did everybody have a chance to look at them? Anybody have any comments on the minutes or changes?
I did.
Yes, go ahead.
On the sixth paragraph where it says Ms. Gray gave an update on retirement benefits, I do not believe that is correct. I believe that
Which page do you want, sir?
On the first page.
Okay.
Yeah.
That would be Ms. Odom.
I believe that would be Ms. Odom.
Correct, okay.
And
okay, hold on 1 second, Dick.
All right.
Okay.
And on the last page, at the top where it says Suzanne Odom says she worked for Beaufort County Hospital for 10 years, I believe that I was, that should be Suzanne Gray. And that was a hypothetical situation. I have never worked for Beaufort County Hospital, but that was a hypothetical situation that I was given to Frankie, and if I left the impression that I worked there, that needs to be corrected.
All right, so...
she would have liked to work there.
Susan Gray.
Yeah.
Okay. Richard?
Yes.
What page?
There was a statement Jim Christmas had asked about the liability on the cost report. He was referring to the Medicaid cost report, and the minute mentioned Medicare. So it's very important to make a distinction with Medicare and Medicaid.
That second
statement had to do with a $300,000 possible amount due to the Medicaid program. We never anticipated an amount due to the Medicare program.
Okay, is that on the second page? Third paragraph down?
I don't have a hard copy.
All right, let me read it back to you. Jim Christman asked what the liability would be relating to the Medicare report. He said he remembers it being around $300,000. That should be Medicaid?
Yes, that is correct.
Okay. Okay, anybody have any other changes? All right, with those changes, can I have a motion to reapprove the agenda? I mean, the minutes?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any negative? No? Hearing none, minutes approved. Okay, before we get the update, I do have one announcement. Harold Camus, as of yesterday, he sent me an email yesterday resigning from the board effective immediately. So I just want to advise everybody on that. So, of course, we'll be fine. I'll make those changes on it. All right, next agenda item is an update on the Biden-Beaufort Hospital. We have with us Harvey Case, the president. And with that, I'll turn it over to you, Harvey.
Okay. Well, I'm going to go up here.
That's fine.
Have a presentation.
That's fine.
Good to be here. It's been a year since I reported on the hospital, and I think there's been a lot of progress made, so this should be a good report for you all. Please stop me at any point and ask questions. Be as interactive as you'd like it to be. So the first thing is the financial performance, and this represents fiscal year 15, which runs from September 1st through, October 1 through September 30, 2015. is divided between the hospital Vidant Medical Group, which is really the physician practices, and then there's a total line. So I'm going to kind of highlight a few areas. If you look at our patient revenues, these are actually what we charge patients. We charge about $213 million for the year. Jump down to total net revenue. Of those charges, total net revenue represents really how much cash do we expect to collect. So we expect to collect about $76 million of that. So as you can see, we write off over 60% of what we charge, which is fairly typical in healthcare. So we have $76 million to pay our bills, and you jump down to operating expenses. I'm going to jump down to total operating expenses first. We have $83.5 million in operating expenses. About $43 million of that is salaries and benefits. So that's really the bulk of where we spend our money. It's very labor intensive. If you take the cash we expect to collect of $76 million less the $83.5 million, that puts us at an operating deficit of $7.6 million for the year. Net loss, which includes some interest income, about a $7.3 million loss for the year. The hospital had a fairly successful year. Every year it's been getting better the operations, so it was roughly break-even, while the physician practices still continue to lose quite a bit of money. That's kind of what's happening in the industry wherever you go. And some of it's based on a number of factors, what's going on in the federal and state government. We're dealing with payment cuts. And so that's where we're going to put a lot of focus for our attention on in the coming years. The next slide deals with capital expenditures. I'm sorry, this is so small, it's probably difficult for you guys to see. But I'm going to pinpoint a few of them. The first one is, if you kind of think of the lease agreement over the first 5 years, Biden is expected to spend $21 million. So this represents the first 4 years through fiscal year 2015. Kind of highlighted a couple under the hospital, which represents Biden, Beaufort, and the black at the top. There's about right at $5 million on the EHR, electronic health record. If you jump down to the bottom under the clinics, it's another $2.2 million. So over $7 million is spent on just electronic health records alone. Jumping back to the top, patient beds, $306,000. Patient beds are very, very expensive. They're not like your typical beds you go out and buy. And of course, when we took over, there's a lot of aged equipment, things that are out of, you know, out of life, out of service. New elevators, we replaced two of the elevators. We call these the 1957s because they represent when the hospital was built, $575,000. We're actually replacing the east wing elevator. We were hoping it was going to be about $250,000. Looks like the price is going to be about double, but if you kind of jump near the bottom, you'll see something called east elevator renovation. That really deals with the engineering piece of that. So that should be happening this year. That's moving forward. Going back to the top, Shepherd Cancer Center, you guys have heard a lot about the expansion of that, $3.8 million, patient infusion pumps, $400,000. Exterior waterproofing, that's just one phase of the hospital. There's a lot of moisture penetration throughout the hospital, but we did seal one end of it. It looks like a different color if you guys are familiar with that. We went with a different color because if we put a clear coat on it, it doesn't last. So we had to pick something that would have a lasting benefit. And so again, that was about $400,000. Patient telemetry monitors, $550,000. And again, so about $19 million through the first 4 years. And I'll talk a little bit about what's going on with capital this year in a few minutes. Something we're pretty excited about is we put a lot of focus on making sure that we deliver great care when people come in the doors. So there's a little bit different, we call quality safety, there's a little bit different quality is things such as, are we following evidence-based medicine? Are we doing what you call best practice care? And we monitor that. And we monitor it based on the way the federal government asks us to. So if you look at provide optimal care, we were doing that in 2014. That's something we worked on a number of years. That dealt with heart attacks, heart failure, certain measures the government asked us to measure. And we kind of hardwired that pretty good. We were at 98% that year. We continue to do well, but that's just, it's kind of fallen off our things that we monitor. We kind of try to hardwire something and move on to other measures. So some of the other measures are stroke, inpatient psychiatric optimal care, blood clot, immunization, outpatient core measure scores. And again, these are things that we would do for each one of those that represents a best practice in that area. So if you look at stroke in 2014, we're 82%. In 2015, we moved up to 89%. So far in 2016 through the first 6 months of the year, we're actually at 100%. So these things might sound very simple, but there's a lot of complexity to what we do. So, but making progress there. Psychiatric optimal care has moved up to 98%. Blood clots, 100% compliance. Immunization, again, 99%. Outpatient core measure scores, again, 96%. One of the areas that we did not hit our metric on was early deliveries. And we understood that. We had a shortage of pediatricians in the area for a period of time, and some of the C-sections had to be planned out. And one of them happened to be, we had a couple that were actually a day before. You have to get 38 weeks, and the government or the state is now asking that you don't deliver before 38 weeks. So a couple of them were delivered, I think, a day before that. But anyway, this year is 0%, so we're hitting that metric in 2016. One of the ones I want to spend just a minute to talk about is mortality, O to E. And to explain what that means is, O means occurred. How many deaths did you actually have in the hospital? And then E represents how many did you expect? So what you really want is a number under 1.0. As you can see here, in 2014, we had 1.63. In 2015, we had 1.26. So let me talk a little bit about this measure. So I'm going to talk about the denominator, expected. Well, if you just look at this number, you're going, wow, there's more people dying in the hospital than should be dying in the hospital. So when we got these numbers, we started digging through them. And a part of the expected number is how well you're documenting how sick your patients are that are coming in through the door. So for example, if a patient comes in our hospital and the physician documents they have pneumonia, well, that's very different than documenting they had pneumonia, but they also had COPD, they had diabetes, they had all these other conditions that would make them more likely to have a negative outcome. So we found out, compared to the system levels, that our physicians were not documenting to indicate how sick our patients are. So in the last half of last year, we really focused on the documentation and saw great improvements in that area. So if you can, and I'll talk about this year in just a minute. So again, a big part of our issue is related to the documentation end. And we've made great progress. The other piece is the occurred. How many folks are actually, you know, dying in hospitals? Well, for one thing, people do go to the hospitals to die these days. Folks, other parts of the country are maybe inpatient hospice facilities. Some folks in other parts of the country, people may decide to die at home. Typically in Eastern Carolina, a lot of folks don't want folks dying at home. So anyway, but we have focused on one area where people do die often around the country, and that's on sepsis. Sepsis is really an infection that takes over the body. So in the last year and a half, we put a great deal of effort on our sepsis protocol system-wide, and we actually were the pilot of something called MUSE, which is a modified early warning system in our inpatient unit. So United Medical Center in Greenville and Beaufort piloted this program, and we've been piloting this for about 8 months. We've really kind of worked out the kinks, but it's really an early warning system. So if a patient has a number of things that happen, such as if they're on the inpatient unit and we notice that their blood pressure's going up, or the heart rate, respiratory rate, the temperature, this system scores it. And so if it hits a score of 3 or 4, nursing does certain steps or certain protocols that nursing would take. If it hits a score of 5, then nursing has to get with a physician and inform them of things. So it really just alerts people to change, subtle changes in condition. It could be the changing in condition of one major change or a lot of subtle changes, but it's really a program that we're gonna roll out through the rest of the system. So anyway, we have put a lot of effort into this measure. This is one of the measures that, when you think of CMS 5-star ratings, Blue Cross and all of those, they look at this rating to determine whether you're a safe hospital. A hospital where you get good care. So we have put a lot of effort into this. And the good thing is people were not dying in our hospitals unnecessarily. It's just that we were not capturing primarily the expected number. We were not documenting that. If you look at where we are in 2016, we're at 0.87, which represents that if you expect one person to die, 0.87 people are dying in the hospital. So doing a much better job in that area. Any questions on that? It's a little bit complicated, but that's the way the measure is calculated. safety.
Well, I'm just curious. Who decides who's expected to die? Where is that put down?
There are statistics that show if somebody has like simple pneumonia, there are statisticians that say X number of people will die if they have simple pneumonia. So this is it's national data.
It's already a set statistic.
And it's not ours.
Thank you.
If you look at safety represents things in the hospital when people are there. Are we causing them any harm? Are we allowing them to be in a harmful environment? So it's a little bit different from quality. So if you look at the events of harm we had in 2014, we had 6. In 2015, we had 3. And so, you know, again, making improvement. And this doesn't happen by chance. This happens because you're very, very focused on the patient and the outcomes. If you look at a couple of events that we had in 2015, it was falls with harm. We do a lot of steps to make sure that our patients do not harm themselves. However, sometimes patients kind of have their own mind, and you know, even if they're a high-risk fall, we might have them on bed alarms. We might say, hit the call bell. We make sure they have certain slippers on so they don't slip, but sometimes people just want to get out of bed on their own. They think, I can get up and go to the bathroom. I can get up and go to the chair and get out of the bed. And they're just very independent, but it is our job to keep them safe, but we did have 2 falls with harm in 2015. Medication errors with harm, we had 0. Stage 3 and 4 pressure ulcers, we had 0. We did have 1 blood clot DVT in the year. Then hospital-acquired infections. And these are infections as defined by the federal government. So the federal government did not include C. diff in this particular one. But this was the first year that I can remember working with any hospital where we had 0 hospital-acquired infections. And especially if you think of catheter-related infections, people used to leave Foley's in patients for, you know, for as long as they were there because it was very convenient for nurses and doctors. You didn't have to worry about getting them up, taking them to the restroom. However, when you leave a Foley catheter in, every day you keep it in, your chances of getting a hospital-acquired infection goes up. So there are bundles, there are best practice measures to say, you know, how are you doing? So in that example, I'll give an example of a bundle for a Foley. You have to make sure that the lines are not twisted. You have to make sure the lines are labeled. You have to make sure that the Foley is below the bladder. You need to make sure your bed is raised a certain amount of degrees. So you have to check it daily. But there are a lot of best practice measures that we do to drive this number down. So we're very, very proud of having no hospital-acquired infections for the year. Mm-hmm. Looking at patient experience, so you know, we talked about quality, we talked about safety. This represents you know, what the patients are thinking about us. So some of the flow things that we're working on is reducing ED wait time. Now this is a huge challenge because if you looked at our emergency department, when it was built, and it was built for about 50 visits per day. And when it was built for 50 visits per day, that was at the time when behavioral health patients came in and stayed for days. So it's been a real challenge for us, and hospitals are, you know, around the country. How do we deal with this change? But we have looked at a lot of flow improvements. So one of those, looking at the median time for ED patients that arrived to the time they departed for admitted patients. So the goal was 301 minutes, that was the actual 2014. And we ended up 2015 at a little bit better at 276 minutes. So although the hospital we're seeing about 76 patients per day, again, it was built for 50, seeing 76 per day is quite a challenge. Some days are better than others because I'm giving you averages. So you can imagine some days we see 90 and some days we see 60 or 55. So it's on those very difficult days when we still get some, you know, long wait times. You know, 3, 4, 5 hours, and so does everyone else. But until we kind of remedy the size of the ED and get it the right size, that's going to be a challenge. And another one of our goals is to try to keep people out of the ED that don't need to be there. But that's a longer-term project that we're working on as well. So another measure is admit decision time to ED departure time for admitted patients. So once the hospitals have said, okay, this patient does need to be admitted, how long does it actually take them to get upstairs? And you might say, well, why is that important? Well, one is to get the patient out of the ED so we can see more patients are waiting in the lobby. But anyway, we made a little bit of progress on that. Went from 51 to 50 minutes. But again, these are moving targets. Different patients, you know, come in every day, different times. So some days the challenge is the beds upstairs are full, so it's hard to get patients in. The last one I'm just talking a little bit about is readmission rates. So the federal government measures this, and readmission rate can be a good indicator, but then and sometimes it's not. So if you think about readmission rates, the government has what you call an all-inclusive readmission. So we have a patient that was discharged from the hospital with, I'm going to say, pneumonia. They were discharged home, and 3 weeks later, they get in a car wreck, and they get readmitted. That's a readmission. If they fall in their yard, trip, fall, break their hip, that's a readmission. So sometimes it doesn't make a lot of sense, but it's an all-inclusive readmission. Another part of readmissions is the socio-demographic areas that you're in. So in other words, or socio-economic, if you go to areas where, you know, you're very rural and transportation's an issue, people don't have money to buy medications, most likely they're not taking care of themselves when they get out of the hospital, can't go get the right follow-up care. Those patients do get readmitted more frequently. And if you kind of think about the areas that we serve, that's kind of what happens in these areas. We serve a great geographic area, but transportation is an issue. So 9.42, we made some progress. If you look at 2016, I think we're under 8%. However, this is an interesting one to measure. One of the other things I will just kind of update you on, and maybe I'm telling you too much, but there's just some interesting things that go on that we measure. I talk about mortality, right? I talk about the mortality ODE ratio. So if someone comes in the hospital, they're admitted, and we say this person's really here to die because they're just kind of on this the last stage of their life, and it's obvious. Typically, they would go to hospice care. So we can discharge them from acute care and then readmit them into hospice care. Well, that's great for your mortality because it kind of puts that where it should be, but it counts as a readmission too. So it's kind of a crazy world we live in. So, but if we all, if you're in healthcare, we all live within the same rules. Again, looking at our experience, we do measure inpatient experience. Back in 2014, you just got an overall rating. We were at 73rd percentile. In 2015, the federal government moved to 9 questions they would ask. And what they give you credit for is, are you in the top 75% in the country? And you have to get a 9 or a 10 on a 10-point scale. You have to get a 9 or a 10. If you get a call, you get credit. If you get an 8, that doesn't count. So in our goal was to have at least 6 of 9. Our ultimate goal was 9 of 9. In 2015, we finished with 5 of our 9 questions in the top 75%. I'm glad to say the 4 that we did make it there, they were all in the top 38%. So we're well above the national average in all of those. But we would like to be 9 of 9. So we're doing a pretty good job there. On the outpatient, if you look at, we were at the 82nd percentile, hit the 77th percentile, you know, again, in the top 25% there. We'd like to be, you know, above that number, but still doing a pretty good job. The emergency department is our continued challenge, and again, we'll talk about that in a minute. However, we were at the 32nd percentile, so we're not doing near as well as we would like to do. Again, that relates to more patients showing up at our ED than we can handle on any given day. So we'll talk a little bit about what we're going to do about that. I won't go through this because this is just a summary of those other detailed spreadsheets. This is a summary sheet to talk about our quality year. Quality initiatives, I'll pick out a few. Again, I'll talk about the MUSE pilot. The MUSE, again, deals with sepsis protocols that we have on the inpatient unit, and that's going to be rolled out system-wide. We also now do PIC lines in-house. In the past, at times, we would have to send a patient out to Greenville, perhaps, to get PIC lines or use a contract service. We have now trained in-house personnel, and that's going very, very well. So it just makes it more convenient for our patients. CHATS is an acronym that we developed within our hospital, and it deals with little things that we need to remember for safety, such as CHATS could represent communication, handoffs, and so forth. And this has been rolled out system-wise. It's something that our people right here in Beaufort County developed for us system-wide. And again, you see the fourth bullet down, patient safety coach, sit around safety habits. Again, every day we talk about safety in the hospital. We believe in when people of Beaufort County or surrounding areas come to the hospital, you know, there's kind of a promise that we give, and every day our goal is to make sure we achieve that promise. A few other things, perform daily checks. A few years ago when we started doing checks, we were not doing daily checks. Then roughly four years ago, we started doing checks 5 days a week. And we got better. If you look at our quality metrics, we started getting better, because if a patient was going to leave the hospital without getting one of the best practice measures, we had people going behind the doctors and nurses to say, did they get those? So we were doing those 5 days a week, but if you understand, we're in a 24/7 business, so we moved that to 7 days a week. And that takes more resources to do, but however, that's yielding better results. Tell-us now rounds for inpatient units. That's where we are asking the patients, if they have a problem with us, let us know. We want to get better. You know, sometimes I do get complaints from the community, and I'll tell you, as bad as you hate to hear them, that's the only way you can get better if you want to hear them. You want to hear them so you can figure out how you can do things in a different way and a better way. Added urinary catheters to our daily checklist to make sure that nurse-driven protocols are followed. Again, we learn from our mistakes. Before that wasn't done, so we're doing those today. So I'll just move on. System improvements. We do have we'd like to have more, but we do have one patient family advisor. And what this means is we have someone from the outside that doesn't work for the hospital that comes in, they attend meetings, they tell us what their perspective is versus what we think it should be. I'll tell you, you can get, you know, it's kind of like if you're so involved in the work, sometimes you can't see things. And we always think we have good ideas for patients, but it's interesting what their ideas might be versus what we think. So that's been a good program for us. We also do that system-wide. And then, again, tell us now rounds, which I mentioned. And on the inpatient unit, that has really been great for us. We have one of our nurses that they go around 3 days a week, and they go and ask very detailed questions to our inpatients. And basically they're saying, can you tell us about our stay? Is there something we can do better? And we found out a lot of good information. Some of the complaints we get relates to noise. It gets noisy at hospitals at night. And if you kind of think about it, we don't have carpet in our locations. We don't have things that kind of, you know, beat down sounds. So we're working very hard to try to, you know, make the noise a little bit better. Trying to, you know, dim the lights at 10 o'clock at night. Because we also have an open door policy. We try to make sure families feel like they can come and stay. But if you think about, some folks have big families and loud families, it's kind of a balance. So anyway, but over the last 6-8 months, the Tell Us Now rounds have given us great information, and we're getting better. Some of it deals with, you know, the cafeteria. Hey, I didn't get my breakfast on time. This is not what I wanted. I mean, there's all kinds of great information. Some of it's attitude amongst staff here and there. I mean, we just find out what we need to work on. Community benefits. I don't know if you can see this. It's even hard for me here. But anyway, awareness campaigns, community health education, health screening, $67,000. Community benefit operations. That's primarily our internal staff, $40,000. Internships, preceptorships. We have a great investment there, $325,000. Clinical trials, $131,000. Cash and in-kind contributions, $141,000. Most of that is the community benefits grant, and I'll go through that in just a little bit more detail. That's $141,000, and community building activities, $21,000, so about $725,000 there. So if you think about those community benefit grants, we have a board that's made up of community members that, where the Vital Health Foundation gives out $100,000 to each community they're in. And this community, and this group of our Beaufort County community, they come in and they review applications to see who's worthy of getting this money. First of all, there's lots of great candidates. However, there's only $100,000. When you start asking people, really the need is probably a lot greater than that. But in the past year, you can see where $111,000 was spent. Some of the health department, Higher Heights, Boys and Girls Club, Coastal Practice, Eagles Wings, Food Bank, and so forth. But we get great pleasure out of seeing how we can make a positive contribution to the county, because these are, again, much needed. Community benefits, if you look at total unreimbursed care, that really represents bad debts, or what we call bad debts. And the way you kind of the term of that is people that you think can afford to pay their co-pays, deductibles, or whatever, they don't pay them. And the charity care is those that don't pay them, but they're deemed that they don't have the financial means to pay them. You guys understand that. So there's over $6 million tied up into those two areas. Some of the goals that we have for 2016, really everything follows under three important areas: quality, patient experience, and finance. You have to have all of these things to have really a good outcomes, but we're going to focus on employee engagement. That's how you really take the hospital to the next level. It's where you get everyone one kind of rowing the boat together. And we have a lot of great employees, but still we have opportunity to do things in a better way, and we're working very hard on that. Improvement to the value to the patients by focusing on reducing waste. I think you all know people don't want to pay more for health care. They don't want to pay for things that are redundant. They don't want to pay for wait times. So we're working a lot on process improvement. We have two people that specialize in Six Sigma, lean waste reduction. So we're putting a great deal of time in those areas, trying to drive down our cost footprint. And that's kind of the wave of the future for us. We're going to have to focus on how do we continue to do things with better outcomes at less cost, so like everyone else. Improving access to primary care. Obviously, this is a national issue. However, we're very focused on how we're going to do a better job here in Beaufort County. And then preparing for an ED expansion renovation plus infrastructure. And I'm going to spend just a minute talking about that as well. Any questions on the goals? Some of the things, these are just requirements in the lease. So there are statements that represents we certify. We have developed and operating pursuant to a strategic and financial plans for the hospital and the clinics. We participate in the Medicare and Medicaid programs. We maintain access to primary care for the service areas, for area residents to operate in hospitals and clinic. We certify that we have not enacted financial admission policies that deny access to care. And these are just other statements that we're making. And I believe also Joe mentioned that insurance certificates were provided to him. So I think this represents the lease requirements is what I've been over. One of the things I did want to spend just a minute to talk about is something that's kind of exciting for us is the emergency department expansion and renovation. For some that have had to go to our ED, this is what you would see. So it does the job, but it's certainly nothing to brag about. It's not pleasant to the eye. It's not what you really want to see in a modern community hospital or a urban hospital. So one of the things that we're doing is we've got about a $14.6 million project, and it's focused on an ED renovation expansion as well as some infrastructure requirements that are greatly needed. If you're standing on Highland Drive looking from the Vidant Orthopedics practice, this is kind of what it would look like. So this would represent looking from that direction to the hospital. So this is what the future of that side would look like from Highland Drive. This is going to be a two-phase project. So the first phase is going to represent tearing down the current education AHEC space and building a 9,000 square foot new standalone ED. And this new ED will have 12 beds, new trauma rooms, a new nursing area, great patient flow, a new walk-in family entrance area, certainly a canopy to oversee that, a nice registration area, waiting area, certainly something that's greatly needed in Washington here. Next slide. Just another view. The second phase will represent the first phase is going to take probably, it'll start roughly in October of this year. It's going to take roughly 16 months to get that completed. Once that's completed, we're going to move the current ED over to this new ED and then start renovations on the old. And the great thing is when this is completed, that section will take about another 6 months. And when that's completed, we'll have an additional 4 beds. We'll have a dedicated isolation area, dedicated decontamination area. A lot of things that we don't really have today. Privacy issues will kind of go away, a much better flow. just a much better home setup for us and nursing and the physicians as well. Our patient advisor sat in on this, Dr. Anthony Frank, who is the system ED director. He's actually the medical director for our hospital as well. He sat in on all of these and helped design what he thought would be the best for patients. And one of the things he's kind of pointed out was if you see those patients walking out, those are happy patients, so we're all happy about that. It's kind of really good. So this is, again, looking from more of the 12th Street side of things, what you see going that direction. I don't know if you can see this well. However, if you look at the blue, I wish I brought my pointer in, and I did, so I apologize. The blue section represents the parking, but also, if you see that new section, that's going to represent the new 9,000 square foot addition. And we're going to have to obviously change parking and others. And you kind of see where there's a turn, where you turn and drive into the pedestrian entrance. The purple section up there represents we're going to redo the EMS where they come in, because that's not a great setup there. So we're going to give them a canopy, so if it's raining or the weather's bad, they have a better entrance in there. And so that's a part of it. And then I guess that's a yellow color. I'm halfway colorblind. The yellow-green area represents the existing EED. That's going to be where we're going to do some renovations. One of the other pieces I mentioned was we're going to do some infrastructure upgrades. About $8 million of this big project is going to go for the ED expansion renovation, but there's about another $5 million plus that's going towards infrastructure upgrades. We're having to redo the power plant, because the power plant is very dated. That's about a $3.3 million project. There's a lot of issues related to that side of the business, and so this has been on a long-term plan and said this had to be fixed at some time. However, our engineers and architects said, or our engineer said, this needs to be done during this project. You cannot add on to it. We're going to make sure that we have redundant fuel sources, replace our generators. HVAC system, that really represents the east wing of the hospital. The HVAC system is behind. It can get pretty hot. It was warm up there yesterday. So this will tackle that issue as well. Fire pumps. Our fire pumps barely meet the minimum guidelines for the sprinkler systems, so we're going to have to replace that whole pump system. So we can't really add on any space until we get that replaced. So again, $14.6 million project, again, kicking off sometime in October. And I can tell you our staff is really excited about this. That concludes the presentation I have, but I'm very open to. Yes, sir.
I have a quick question.
Sure.
You said the first phase is 9,000 square feet. When you move the old part over, what's the square foot going to be on the total of the year?
We're going to renovate about 3,500 square feet of the existing space.
So are you saying it's going to be
12,500 ballpark?
Okay.
I'll round it just a little bit.
That's fine. Thank you.
Is it possible to get a lot of documents?
You want to keep the power for me? Or you want a something in
either way.
Paper form? Yeah, absolutely.
Okay.
Jerry, I've got it.
Okay.
Any questions?
The biggest population that comes in that doesn't pay at that hospital is coming through that emergency room. I'm guessing. My question is, we know that this state didn't do Medicaid expansion, but when it comes to, and you may not know this, but the working poor that got Obamacare insurance or whatever, has that helped with any revenue base? Because most of those people that I've talked to have like deductibles of like $10,000. So they're still using the ED. And you're talking about this population in this area is not exactly changing a whole lot. So I'm just curious, with all this renovation, what do you see as a better revenue coming through just that particular area, or do you see one? Or do you see how a hospital is going to help with the lack of revenue?
That's a good question. I'm trying not to get the political side of it, but we deal with kind of what's in front of us.
Yeah.
you know, for a number of years, we have seen copays and deductibles go up.
Yeah.
And obviously, good people have great intentions, but, you know, you choose whether you're going to pay your hospital bill or you're going to pay your light bill.
Right.
You know, mm-hmm. are you going to do things for your family, your kids, or pay your... So that is a challenge. Mm-hmm. And so there's people that make choices. And again, if you go from a $500 out-of-pocket to a $5,000, that's a big challenge. And people are also starting to shop for health care. You know, as more is coming out of their pocket, they're kind of saying, who has the best outcomes and who's going to charge me the least amount of money? So we're having people are now shopping. So 5 years ago, that didn't really happen. So that's actually a good thing. You know, competition, we think, is a good thing. I think it helps us get better. But, you know, the truth of the matter is we're going to have to figure out, and we are working on this, how do we make sure that when people need access to care, they're going into the lowest cost setting, the appropriate setting. And often the emergency departments are not your lowest cost setting. So as population health transitions more to where the government's going to say, here's your pot of money, you take care of these folks, we're going to have to figure out how to make sure we get them out of the ED into the right setting. And we're already doing some things like that, especially with behavioral health patients. We're working right now, we have a grant through the KB Reynolds program, but we're trying to look at patients that have a behavioral health and also diabetes or another medical condition. And we're trying to make sure that as they come to the ED, we're trying to figure out how do we put them in a more appropriate setting. But that's going to be our responsibility as time comes. And, you know, when you talk about revenue is not something we talk about as much now as we talk about cost. How do we, because we're not, we probably won't get paid on revenue as much in the future as we pay, how do we get, again, a bucket of money? How do we drive down, bend that cost curve down? And you do that also by making sure that your outcomes are good, provide timely care. And if somebody is admitted in the hospital, you make sure you get them out timely. And you make sure that they don't show up as a readmission. You make sure they get their appointment at the primary care doctor within 7 days. There's a lot of things we're going to have to do that's really outside the walls of the hospital. And that's how folks will survive. So we're not alone in that. That's kind of a system-wide, or excuse me, a national approach. Good question.
Harvey, there was a slide up there about capital improvements, and I think the total was somewhere around $19 million.
Right.
And Joe may correct me, but I think the requirement, the lease, was something like $20
million.
21 over 5 years.
5 years. And some of the things on that list, I think, were, I just eyeballed it, but probably 60% were actually in infrastructure for the building. Some were things like beds, and they may qualify for that. But, you know, I think about if I'm renting a property and I have a tenant in there and they're buying a toaster, it doesn't do me a lot of good when the toaster doesn't. But when you're making an upgrade, infrastructure upgrades to the cancer center, I think was one that was actually on the list that was named. I saw that on there. And the Jerry will remember the, I think you all fixed the elevators. Is that correct? There was one years ago, the county had looked at financing about $17 million and we took the elevators off, I think. As Jerry likes to say, we kicked the can down the road some on that one. But but I saw those things. So it looked like about 60% of the dollars on there were probably actually in infrastructure. Would you agree with that?
I've not ran the numbers, okay. But I could, it's just like the ED's 14 point.
Right.
So that's all infrastructure.
Okay.
So that's a big one. So obviously we're in it for the long run. Some of the equipment, you know, we're working on those pieces as well. But there's a lot of dated equipment as well. It still functions, but you know, we're looking to try to we're looking at even our computers and all those pieces. How do we get on a schedule of replacement?
So it was that you all have done quite a bit on the cancer center, is that right?
Yes.
Correct.
Okay. Yes.
And then the ED is about $15 million.
Right.
Okay. Is there anything else in the infrastructure, like inside the interior, that you've done? I mean, that you think of major.
Well, again, we're working on the other elevator as we speak. That's kind of, dollars have already been set aside for that. Of course, the dollars came in twice as much as we thought, which is everything seems to do. But that's kind of on the slate for this year. It's just a matter of, again, it's not as easy as saying we want to do it. Somebody shows up next week. There's a lot of planning that goes into elevator replacement. But we're also looking at the inpatient rooms and trying to decide on, you know, what we're going to do. Our rooms are small. We kind of like to say we have small rooms and big hearts. That's kind of our slogan. But they're small, and, you know, we have some, but we provide great care. But we're looking at those pieces. But, again, we're trying to balance system-wide things as well. So if you go to our community hospitals, everybody, just like we were talking about budgeting earlier, there's always, you know, more needs than there is money. So it's a balance.
You talked about new beds. Can you get those new beds through those doors and those old?
The doors are big enough.
Really?
Yeah, you have to make a couple turns to get them, you know, through the turn. Yeah. That's how the older hospitals were built, you know, 70 years ago.
The moisture intrusion issues y'all been dealing with, you've done the first phase of that. I guess that continues throughout the rest of the exterior walls.
That's correct. That's going to be phased, but eventually the hospital will match up to it a lot better than it does today. But that was the first phase. I mean, that was the worst area where water was penetrating. In hospitals, certainly, unlike some places, moisture is a big deal with infection rates, and there's a lot of regulatory requirements related to moisture and humidity. So that's something we had to deal with, you know, and we worked on, you know, the roots as well. I don't think I mentioned up there, we've also replaced the roof on general surgery here and also the clinic in Aurora, too. So there's a lot of infrastructure things going on in other places.
So what's the time frame on the rest of that moisture intrusion exterior walls?
I don't know it right offhand. I'd have to go look at the five-year plan. And sometimes a five-year plan moves based on there's a system need that pops up a little bit higher, a little bit, you know. So as things move, it gets moved, but it is on our five-year plan. But I don't know exactly, Brian.
Thank you. Any other questions? Well, thank you. Excellent presentation.
Thank you. Well, good news story. And so it's going to be, healthcare is challenging going forward, but I think we're up for it. I look forward to doing great things in the county.
Thank you.
All right. Next agenda item is updates on the outstanding settlements, filings.
Sue Odom can speak to the 401k.
Okay. Sue, you want to speak to the 401k?
Sure. Good morning, everybody. How's everybody today?
Good. Yourself?
Fine, thank you. I just have a very, very brief update on the 403b plan. Everybody in the room may recall that we had made a submission to the Internal Revenue Service, received a compliance statement that affirmed everything that we plan to do with the 403b plan in terms of funding it. And the check has been issued, deposited into the plan. A week ago, I spoke with Alex, who's the administrator responsible for allocating the funds, gave them the final direction they needed. There was some confusion on their part in terms of whether the contribution was representing prior years or just an earnings adjustment, and it is the latter, it's an earnings adjustment. And so they now have all the information that they need to get the funds allocated. I was expecting an update yesterday, but I did not receive one from them. This is apparently a very busy time of year for them with all the testing they do and all the outreach they do and the 400s they're preparing with the Memorial Day holiday right here upon us. So apparently I didn't receive the update, but they know that our objective was to try and get all those funds allocated to the affected participants' account by the end of the month if possible. So they are shooting for that goal. If they miss it, hopefully it will only be for a couple of days. And then once those funds are allocated, then we will get shifted over within balance to their plan termination team. And we will likely need to work on some paperwork to formalize the termination of the plan, and I'll be working with Frankie on that, and Ron, and well, likely this group also. But we will formally terminate the plan, and with that resolution and direction to ballot, they then will issue the plan termination paperwork to the participants, which will inform them that they'll be receiving distributions from the plan. They'll have an opportunity to roll it over. Our intention, or at least the preliminary thinking with Frankie, is that we probably will issue a communication with them, or to them along with it, that tells them about the allocation, the corrective allocation that was made to their account, We'll give them a contact person at Vitus who has been playing an important part in the HR department in this Lucas plan. Obviously, these are people who previously maintained the plan for them, and everybody knows them. And so we will want to give that contact information. We'll want to inform them of the ability to roll the money into the balance, the Vitus plan, assuming that's available. And then once that is all completed, then we'll be done. So all the contacts be fully liquidated from the plan in order for the termination to be complete. So again, we're awaiting the final allocation of funds before we begin those final steps. But once we begin those final steps, then we're down in the weeds in terms of timing. My hope would be that it would take, it's going to take at least 30 days after the termination paperwork is sent. But hopefully, with our fingers crossed, we're talking about a 30 to 90 day time frame as opposed to something longer than that. So we've made tremendous progress, and I think everybody should be pleased by that. And that's what I have by way of update. Does anybody have any questions?
Sue, who generates that paperwork, the correspondence and the whatever the...
The paperwork is going to be pretty generic. It's just likely going to be a ballot that has some standardized plan termination paperwork that people receive. If there's like a distribution notice that follows an IRS model, so it's going to be about usually about a 9-page stack paper. Now, if our intention is to add communication to it about what has been done by way of corrective contributions or the like, then we would be preparing that. We meaning, I would probably be working with Frankie on the initial draft and getting that approved by whoever on the board needs to approve it. But, these kind of communications that we're talking about, these supplemental ones about corrective contributions are like, a couple few sentences long. I mean, very minimal information that's provided. And the most important thing is to give contact person if people have more detailed questions. In my experience, this paperwork that people receive, they don't read anything on it, and they flip to the form where it tells them that they can get their money in cash. I hope that's responsive to the question.
Yeah, that's what I had. Do we know roughly how many individuals we're talking about?
I've received a spreadsheet that has them laid out on there, and I can't. If there's any other questions, I can try to locate that spreadsheet and eyeball the number of people for you.
800, Frankie. And just a rough estimate, Frankie's thinking it may be 800. So, you all are involved in this, I guess, until all 800, if it is 800, all those individuals have remedied or finalized that transition. Is that correct?
Well, we're trying to help shepherd this along for you all, since there is no real quote-unquote HR person at Oakland anymore. But we are working with counsel for Vitus, who is Kelsey Mayo, and the Vitus individuals who have all the names, address, they have all the plan data. And so we will help you see it through to fruition of, completing the termination. But Valid is going to be the one playing the predominant role. We haven't yet nailed down who is actually going to be sending the termination paperwork to the participants. With the 457 B plan that we dealt with previously for Beaufort, I convinced Valid to not follow their standard procedure and actually help us issue that paperwork. But we were dealing with a far, far fewer number of individuals at that point. I don't know if that is going to be the same result for this. If Alex, the retirement plan administrative firm, does not want to handle the actual issuance of the paperwork to people, then we may need to lean on either Vitus or Biden's legal counsel mentioned previously that they have done this kind of paperwork before. It's like a mail merge, you know, and it's the kind of thing that the administrative firms typically do. So we'll see what we're, you know, if we're able to make work some magic again.
And these 800, if it's 800, some of these are still employed at Biden, is that right? But some are not?
It's a combination. And the 800 is the last number that I heard. That's just ballpark. But the purpose of a separate letter going out with the package was just to give them a local feeling for a local contact person with a telephone number. And I've not had a chance to talk with Jamie Tice, but she's been the person that I've been working with on an individual basis as somebody wanted to make a change or needed to borrow money against the plan. But, you know, the letter would be just fairly simple. I would just hate to see us do it from the administrator's point of view and not have something with a local attachment.
Half of them could get chunked in the mail.
But I would like for it to go out all in the same mailing. That, you know, we just prepare the letter, but it goes out in that same package.
That's right. That's, I agree. And, you know, when I've been involved in plenty of, usually pretty much all lawyers do anymore is handle these kind of corrective issues because administrative firms are so intimately involved in all other administrative matters. But normally there is a kind of communication to say, because otherwise they're going to see on their statement. They're going to get a quarterly statement that shows the chunk of money was deposited into their account. And without an explanation, some people actually read their statements and are curious what the money is. And so what communication does is it kind of preempts those questions. It provides the information up front and shows a little bit, you know, it gives a little bit of warm fuzzy to the participants to know that someone's out there looking out for them and explaining things. So it typically is done. It's not legally required, but it would probably be advisable in these circumstances. And forgive me, I'm still trying to get the spreadsheet open that gives the number of participants. And I had to find a password for the spreadsheet, and I'm not very good at working without a mouse. I don't have my mouse on my computer right now, so... bear with me, and I'm still trying to get an answer for you. Does anybody else have any other questions?
Any other questions? No questions at this end.
Okay. Now, were you asking about the number of people who are affected in getting the additional contribution or the total number of participants in the plan?
Total in the plan.
Oh, okay. Well, I don't know that I'm going to have that answer.
That's fine. That's all right. If it's...
spreadsheet I have to have the allocation. So,
I was just trying more think about is it 25 or is it 500, but it sounds like it's more like
it's a big number.
Well, it's probably a sizable number, but you know, these administrators in our firms have experience terminating large plans, and usually what happens when you get down to the wire, there might be some missing addresses for people who terminated years ago. There might be some people who died, and what we do with those is, you know, ultimately, we would probably try to set up a relationship with an IRA rollover provider who, you know, for people who are missing or small balances or, you know, the teens who are trying to locate, sometimes what's done is the funds are rolled over to, you know, automatically rolled over to another vehicle so that the plan can be formally terminated and the person isn't hurt in any way because the money sits somewhere else for them. So we may have to do some of that down to liquidate it. Every plan I've ever worked with that had a termination, we had some of that, especially the one that signed.
And my only concern, Sue, was for, I think the last meeting we had, I think Frankie and actually Brian Allegan was the sort of the pseudo contact person. And I was thinking if this went out to 800 people, when they started getting 600 you know, I'm more thinking of the logistics of who's going to be contacted if they have questions.
Well, what happens, those calls, they're not going to be calling Biden for that. They're going to be given a contact person at Valak to answer questions about their options. Now, they could call Biden in theory, but normally those kind of calls are fielded by the administrative firm who's handling it. The hope would be in giving a Biden contact information that they would only contact Biden if there were questions about the correction that was made.
Right, okay. That's fine.
Okay. And we'd also provide Valak with really a script to explain the correction if they, you know, because they have all these customer services phone numbers and like, you can provide them with scripts to read to people if they have questions so that you can have consistent answers provided and accurate information relayed. So I would attempt to do that as well for their call center. But yeah, you're right. You're absolutely right. That would be an undue burden on Biden.
Well, I'm
to feel that many calls.
Thank you.
I suspect that won't be the case. Chances are, of all the people who receive the communications, most will not respond, meaning that we'll be going with the default distribution option that's chosen, which likely will be a rollover to either an IRA or, you know, another plan. That's just, you know, how human behavior.
Okay.
And I will, you know, continue to crack the whip on this, move this along for everybody, and give you an update the next time I have one.
Good. Hopefully get it to bed soon. Thank you, Sue.
Thank you. At this point, if you don't need me anymore, I'll sign off to help cut.
That's fine, Sue. Thank you very much. Have a nice weekend.
Right. Thank you. You too. Bye-bye.
Richard, you want to go?
No.
Richard, you want to give us an update?
We received the Medicaid sentiment. There's a letter dated May 19th that I sent off to both the board chair and to Joe Cog. That sentiment is a $62,236 amount due to the Medicaid program to the state. And that will finalize the terminating cost report and will essentially be the last of any open Medicaid cost report. So that should wind down that process. And I believe that Joe has prepared the appropriate paperwork for the board to approve and authorize that payment back to the Medicaid program. I will note that in going through this, just a little bit of history, that cost report went through a field audit by Myers and Stauffer back in 2015. That report was basically issued, and I signed off and approved it, I believe, in December of 2015. Then it was submitted to the state in January of 16, and now in last part of May, we have the sediment on that cost report. So that, I guess, would require a motion to approve payment. And I see no reason, based on my reviewing the information, to request any kind of an appeal or reconsideration of that information. Why don't you want to take that up separately?
How much was that? $62,000 and what?
$62,236.
Okay.
Would you like to make that motion?
Yeah.
So moved.
Do you want to make the motion?
So moved.
Okay.
Second.
All right. Any discussion? Hearing none. All in favor? Five say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none. Motion carried. Okay. Done.
Okay, the next item is we've been trying to find out what the holdup was on the Medicare cost report, and I have received a bit of communication with the Palmetto Government Benefits Administrator, and they have acknowledged that there
some error in a system. One of the things that the hospital data showed that there was an additional test that they needed to do related to outpatient settlement. And so basically that stood in kind of the window space waiting for corrective information that has to come out of the Medicare system. So we'll be continue to follow up on that to see what the settlement will come from that tax report. Again, as a reminder, we filed that with an amount due to the hospital. And just for you, again, as a reminder, that the way Medicare has typically worked, if there's a payment due to the hospital, they have submitted that payment electronically, and it ends up being put into the bank account that was acquired by Biden in the lease transaction. So that's a payment, if there is a payment issued, may still have to request Biden to return that money to the escrow account. So we'll continue to watch that. The last thing I have is related to the fact that money was transferred over on an old, this is some transfers from Biden to the escrow account on a form which is a 2010 TRICARE cost report, and that completes that portion of business. So the only open item that I'm aware of and we expect is the Medicare cost report. That's the remaining item in this, the accounting aspect of this transaction. And certainly, I'll open any questions you might have.
On the cost report, the Medicare, you say that's due. Anyone has a guess on what amount of money that could be?
No, I can't do that. What I said was that we filed that report with an amount of money due to the hospital. That amount is around $100,000. Now, because of this final settlement, I could not hazard a guess as to what that might be, whether it's an increase or reduction. That's
Did you say that? What year was that?
2011.
2011.
The terminating Medicare.
Right. Right. That's the
8/31/2011
cost report.
Back in 2000.
Well, he did say. Did, yeah. You did say the TRICARE deposit that was wired to Biden was a 2010 yeah. TRICARE. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Is there a possibility that there's still a 2011 TRICARE?
So I covered that in the last meeting. We're not eligible to file a 2011 report.
Was the 2010 the $12,000 one?
This is correct. This is correct.
Yeah. And that's been transferred.
Yes, it was transferred in April. I believe that's correct.
Questions. Thank you, Rich.
Okay.
Joe.
While we're on the finance topic, I believe that Dick circulated the summaries of the escrow accounts
yes.
as well. And Dick, correct me if I'm wrong, but as of the end of April, it looked like there was about $10,000 left in the professional escrow account, still over $6 million in the excluded. Just for a point of reference, for those who may not recall, at the closing, we established two separate escrow accounts, one for the bulk of the trailing liabilities and then one for professional fees associated with all the trailing liabilities. I don't think anybody, frankly, anticipated that work would really be continuing quite this long, and it is what it is. I will acknowledge that out of that professional escrow account, my firm's fees are paid, Dick's fees are paid, Dixon Hughes fees are paid. Any professional services that this board requires, given the fact that there are no employees for the authority anymore. I don't anticipate any, you know, very large invoices coming in. We're trying to manage the wind down of the retirement plans as cost efficiently as possible. Sue's been doing a really good job trying to get Valak to carry as much of the water as possible, relying on Finance Council to do a good bit of the heavy lifting as well. But it may be between now and the next time this board gets together that some invoices will come due, either from my firm, from Dick, or potentially from Dixon Hughes, depending on the Medicare issues that may need to be addressed related to the 2011 Medicare cost report. And so it may be worth this board going ahead and either authorizing the transfer of some funds from the excluded liability to the professional, or authorizing the chair to make that fund, that to authorize that transfer up to a capped amount, if necessary, between now and the next time this board gets together, with, you know, whether that's 10, 15,000, something
like
that.
If it was a capped amount, what amount do you recommend?
Perhaps 15, just to give us some flexibility.
Yeah. From the escrow account?
That's right. From the account that has over $6 million into it, into the professional that currently has a balance of about 10.
Would the board entertain a motion to...
Oh, please let me make that motion.
Okay.
I motion that we move $15,000 from the escrow account to the professional account to pay for any additional bills that we might incur.
And if I could amend that, historically we've always tried to cap it, I think, around $30,000, if I'm not mistaken. So if you want to just do it $20,000 and have a straight $30,000 in there, I mean, if that's all right with you,
that will be fine.
Prevent us from having to move it in the future.
This is not a part of the amendment. I'm still miffed, and Dick, I want you to hear this, for paying Dixon Hughes for doing what they should have done anyhow. I'm sorry.
All right. So is it going to be $30,000?
But that's not a part of the motion.
$30,000 up to $30,000.
Yeah, up to $30,000.
And just as a point of clarification as well, all of those invoices are, subject to approvals and caps before they're being paid as well.
There's a whole process.
That's right.
So I have that authority. Did you see Merck? You second it?
I thought Frankie did. You were amending it. Somebody
second it. Okay, second it. All right. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor signify, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none, motion carries.
Just one thing, one point of clarification. Do you recall what the trailing liabilities account balance was at closing? Was it $6.8 million?
I believe that's right. I actually may be able to tell you right now.
While he's doing that, I will email everybody the three sheets that I got on the escrow chat. This way, not to worry about paper.
And Dick, it's a balance right now, $6.2 million in that trailing liabilities account?
Well, that's as of the end of April,
remember that? Yeah, okay, gotcha.
It actually was a cash payment of $6.073. The number went up a bit as a result of a few of those trailing cost reports actually resulted in some money coming in, as well as, Dick, you could probably reference this better than I can, but there was a number of opportunities identified, you might recall, in years 2 and 3 following the closing that Dick did a ton of work on, where we were able to actually refile and get some additional money in that was well over $1 million at one point for one of those payments. And so there's the initial amount that Vitan put in was around the $6 million and change range, and that number actually went up a bit following the closing.
Yeah, I would say that early on, there was a lot of interesting and confusing transactions that were going on related to just this complicated lease arrangement, the fact that the terminating tax reports and the fact that the organization, your organization, had to retain the potential liabilities, which also meant they retained any properties outside. And so there were a number of transactions that went on early on that had money going out, money coming in, and it was fairly complex. So, we're at the end of that. I think once we settle the Medicare cost report, but that number did go up and down. Down mostly, I suppose, but it did go up.
And the only other update I can provide in open session for you is that you may recall in those first few years there were also some trailing malpractice-related claims that were coming in, and we've had none that I can that I've been made aware of in the last 12 months. So that's positive news as well.
Do you suggest before we close the meeting, we go to closed session?
If you'd like for a brief moment, I can give you sort of advice from counsel on the report that Biden gave as compared to what's required.
So let's finish a couple of things.
That's fine.
I'll let you take us into closed session. All right, thank you, Rich.
I'll sign off then, unless you have any other questions.
Just one more question.
One more question.
I think this is for Joe, but Dick, you can help us out. We're waiting on the Medicare settlement, which will likely be money into the account.
We hope.
Hopefully.
Zero to hold up.
There's no other settlement that we're waiting on right now, and no other known liability that we have out there that we know of. Is that correct?
I believe that's a fair characterization, Jim. The Medicare cost report is the only known cost report, as Dick said, that's left out there. That we have to provide a caveat that all of these cost reports once the settlement comes in, can be reopened. That's historically been a fairly rare occurrence, and so I don't want to overplay the significance of that. And you need to be aware that is a possibility. But most of the time, once closed, they remain closed. And so that trailing Medicare cost report is the only one out there, and you're right. At the current time, we're not aware of any other material liabilities that remain outstanding.
Yeah. Okay.
Yes, I agree with what Joe just said. And in the 2010 cost report, when they settled it, Medicare specifically said they reserved their right to reopen for a couple of reasons. And they'll probably do something like that when they settle the 2011 cost report. But,
who knows if the likelihood of a
real
thing
would be,
I think,
not material. But we're nearing the end.
Very good. Thanks, Rich.
All right. I'll sign off.
Okay. Thank you. Bye.
Bye.
One thing I should have done up front, I completely forgot about it. We're either going to have to amend the agenda and have a discussion about the vacancy, because Joe, you're recommending we appoint recommend appointment.
That's right.
Or we're going to have another meeting, probably next week or something. So unless somebody has agita against it, I'll amend the agenda for us to discuss any recommendations on appointments to this board.
And just as a point of clarification, Mr. Chairman, the way the process works under the statute for the authority is that this board the process would be for this board to make a nomination or recommendation of an individual to fill that vacancy, to share that with the county commissioners. But under the statute, the county commissioners have the authority to either accept that nomination or to appoint someone of their choosing.
So I'll enter this. I'll ask for a motion to amend the agenda to allow us to have a discussion about some possible names for appointments to the board.
Second move.
Second.
I'll second.
Any further discussion? Hearing none. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Hearing none. And we'll have that discussion. Like I said, and again, I apologize for not doing this up front, but I got the email yesterday that Harold was resigning immediately. So we do have a vacancy on the board. At advice of counsel, he's recommending that we go ahead and fill that. Even though I think the lease only requires that we have six members, but we have nine.
The statute requires it. The bylaws stipulate for nine.
Yeah. So we're having nine. We have nine. So we have one vacancy. I have not spoken to anybody on this. So I do have a name. I don't know if you'd be interested. So I'd like to have maybe two
the three names if we could. I have a gentleman I know very well. It's Rich Richmond. He retired from a major hospital, and I don't even remember which one, someplace in the Midwest. He was a senior VP of operations for the hospital. So he has a wonderful background. I have not spoken to him. My sister came in yesterday. I'd like to throw his name on the table. And if he doesn't do it, I have nobody else in mind. Does anybody have any names they want the board to consider?
I have a question. Are we necessarily have to fill this position?
That's a good question, given the nature of the work we've got left outstanding and some of the other issues going on. However, I would recommend continuing to follow process and following your bylaws so that you can represent, as you take whatever actions might be necessary over the coming months, that you are doing so in full compliance with your organizational documents.
Well, you know, historically it's been really hard to get somebody to serve on this board. And you know, and I'm glad Ron even has a name. All the names that I've ever put forward have
Well, so the key is to try to follow the process.
You
run the process, and if someone turns it down, you keep running the process. And to your point, it doesn't necessarily mean that you will. And again, it's ultimately up to the county to fill the vacancy. It's just this board's role to make a recommendation.
The other issue is that, you know, you think about bringing folks up to speed. That was
yeah, that's concern. What I mean.
You and Howard were the only ones that really had been on the board for when it was the actual operating of the hospital board.
And he should have been the second to do that motion on, because he and I both just love moving that money into that professional. And, you know, as a sidetrack for those of you that might be listening. But anyhow, And I'm looking, I know what you're talking about, Joe, but I'm thinking about the longevity of this board, and I am still living on that. We are at the cusp of finishing everything that this board was supposed to do, and October is coming.
September 1st is coming.
Huh?
Yes.
You're going to bring somebody on now that may have a meeting?
May have a what?
Just have a meeting?
I know that, but I'm just going by. Joe and I discussed this yesterday, and he said he advised legally that we do that, and that, you know, based upon that discussion, I have not talked to anybody about interest or anything else.
The goal here is to follow the process that your organizational documents call for so that you can represent that you have done so.
So if we come up with recommendations to do anything, nobody can contest us saying you didn't follow the process, therefore the action you're taking is whatever.
Well, I would suggest that you guys are commissioners, that you bring up a name at your commissioner board. And
again, the process does call for this board to make a recommendation that the county can accept.
And I think Joe's point is that individual may never ever sit at this table, depending on what happens, but if we're making the effort to continue to follow through with what's in mind. And so then the question is Ron calls this gentleman, or if the commissioners, and you know, is he even willing to sit on the board?
Well, that's my point. We're sitting here thinking about making some recommendations. We've not talked to a body about this, which I think is totally unfair. To recommend somebody that you've not even approached about this, and all of a sudden they get a phone call, this seems a little odd.
Joe, do you have any problems if the county's attorney or the county's manager fills this for the short period of time?
That's another thing we can do.
I mean, you can make whatever recommendation you.
That's a good idea.
I mean, to be either here at the meeting or, you know, Robert Belcher, the county commissioner. I mean, I think we have nothing against your individual.
No, I have no problem with that.
But I think we really need to be looking at Robert Belcher, David Francisco, or Brian Alligat. That's our list.
I said, this board can make whatever nomination it so chooses.
We
have Kathy, who's been on the board previously.
Given my position, I may be involved with drafting or
okay.
documents and stuff.
Yeah, that's I'm going to suggest we cut you out. So we got two people sitting here.
And Brian. Well, I have been on the board since the beginning until just recently, last couple months.
Well, Brian, do you think you should be on it, or since you signed stuff? I don't know. I'm just asking.
Do sign as a representative of the county authorization, so there may be a conflict with that one.
Mr. Chairman, I recommend Robert Belcher.
Set well, he's not here.
Huh?
He's not here. Want to call him? Do you have his number?
This is off the record. You want to turn that camera on?
Is that a commissioners meeting?
We can do.
We have four commissioners. We can't do
that. Yeah, I was trying to say, you can't do that.
We can't do that. You know, no, then we'd have to have an official meeting.
I mean, for process purposes, would it, I mean, if you're going to nominate an individual, perhaps we could all concur,
right,
based on the fact that the individual was actually willing to do it.
I have no idea.
And then we're back to square one if we're not.
That's right.
And are we not?
You're following the process at your next meeting, you would nominate.
Yeah, but what happens if we have to vote on something before the next meeting, before we have another appointee on here? That becomes the issue.
Well, and you can make the recommendation to the county, and that recommendation can be contingent on the acceptance by that individual. And if the individual, for whatever reason, doesn't want to serve, the county can just appoint. You know, you've made your attempt.
We actually had a number of meetings without a representative because of the ping pong back and forth, as you recall, from the county. And the so, as long as we're, I think what you're saying, as long as we're in the process, we can continue to act, make decisions, we're following the bylaws and everything else. So
then I'll take my motion off the floor, my recommendation, and I'll go with your recommendation.
But again, what happens again? What are you saying then if he does not accept?
The county can either ask for this board to make another nomination, or they can just go ahead and appoint someone.
And that's happened before, that we had sent names up there and people just haven't. So we can recommend that your individual, whatever that person's name is.
And if he does not accept, then the board can appoint somebody?
Correct.
Yeah.
You've made your nomination.
We can make another recommendation.
Yeah. Or the county can say, please make another recommendation. You've made a recommendation. The fact that it's, you know, the individual, you obviously can't force anybody to do anything.
No, like I said, I have not even
looked.
In that respect, we're proceeding with the process.
Yes.
That's so if it gets fouled up, we have to start over again, but that's life.
Right.
If you're able to get that within a short amount of time, next couple of days, we'll be able to get it on the June 6th agenda. If not, it would be pushed to the July the 11th agenda. So okay. Timing, just for timing.
So let me ask you a question. If he says no, instead of having a meeting, can I reach out via email to the business committee? Would that be acceptable for another nomination?
One suggestion is that you might want to do is bring the nomination to the Board of Commissioners and just indicate that. Because ultimately, I think the recommendation from this board is just a process. It's really the Board of Commissioners' decision who sits on the board. So if you were to come to the Board of Commissioners meeting, present them with the nomination, and knowing that nominee is not willing to sit, you might have a suggestion from another board member that may be better than that nominee. And then as a Board of Commissioners, you all can just appoint someone to that board.
And then this board accepts it?
We're kind of at the mercy of the seven or the.
Okay, I just want to make sure the process is followed, so nobody can complain that we're not following the process.
That's right.
And this board is involved in the decision making. All right.
So you've made your nomination. Do you want to vote? We need to vote on that. Is that okay?
And then I'll send an email out to the member saying yes, he's accepted the nomination. And if he doesn't, I'll send you an email saying he's not accepted.
And there can't be any, just for clarification, I think in an earlier question, if he doesn't accept, you can't do anything via email as a public body. So
do we need a name for the record here?
Yeah, Rich Richmond.
Rich Richmond. Okay, all right.
And I just, the reason I thought of that is because he has the VP of operations for a major hospital.
Do we approve by consensus, or do we need to vote?
You can vote on that.
Well, they can join the crowd. I just got appointed to the Boys and Girls Club and had no idea.
You got appointed?
Yeah. Yeah,
maybe we can do that. We just
might want to. Welcome to the
board. Well, another morning of the meeting.
So then he's absent at the next meeting.
I like that.
We can't help that.
Yeah, that's wrong. You just.
All right.
You were here to serve.
All right, so somebody make a motion.
I'll make that
somebody
motion.
Somebody second that motion?
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none. Motion carries. Okay. One other thing. Aaron Roberts, who's an attorney with Smithmore Leatherwood, who's the county attorney, is going to appear at the June 6th Board of Commissioners give a presentation on the lease agreement based upon review, I guess, Joe, you and her and the Biden attorney discussed.
That's right.
Yeah. So she'll be appearing June 6th in front of the Board of Commissioners to give that presentation. So we've had the hospital presentation, and we're having a lease agreement presentation at the board, and everybody here is invited to hear that. She will be on the discussion session, which will be right into the public hearing. Right, Brian?
This is,
yes. So that would be really important, so you don't have to stick with holding. All right. Do you want to bring us into closed session?
Sure. I would